Simon & Schuster Audio presents Grimwood, Attack of the Stink Monster by Nadia Shireen, performed by Adam Buxton.
Chapter 1. Dreaming. It was the middle of the night in Grimwood. The leaves on the trees glinted silver in the bright moonlight. All was quiet. All was still.
Ahooga! Ahooga! Ahooga!
Shouted Sharon, the party crow. She staggered through the forest, leaving a trail of glitter behind her.
Where have you been, Shaz? Asked an inquisitive worm.
Hen party!
Said Sharon, peeling off her false eyelashes.
It was outrageous! I laid a massive egg.
Wicked, said the worm.
Sharon's noisy arrival in Grimwood caused a bit of a kerfuffle. Animals started to wake from their deep sleep.
Hoot, hoot, hoot,
said an owl.
Tweet, tweet,
said a little sparrow.
Woof,
said a weird frog.
Yummo, banana time,
said an ant who had just found a banana.
Pipe down, everyone! Some of us are trying to sleep,
said another, much grumpier owl. The grumpy owl was called Frank, and he had been having an excellent dream where he had found a very rare record by legendary jazz musician Gonzo McDougal.
You can have it for free, said the shopkeeper. In fact, take all these expensive records for free, Frank. It's your lucky day. Hoot, hoot.
Oh, wow, said Frank. This is the happiest day of my life.
But then the hoot-hooting of the real-life owl woke him up, and when he realised it had all just been a dream, he was as annoyed could be. Titus the stag was dreaming about finally winning the Grimwood Jamboree, a ruthlessly competitive annual jam-making competition. He entered every year, but always lost out to Cerise La Chance, a local beaver. In his dream, Titus was shaking the hoof of the chief judge, the mayor of Grimwood, and smiling as a golden rosette was pinned to his front. The fact that Titus himself was the mayor of Grimwood didn't seem to matter in dreamland.
It's an honour, said Titus. Your jam was quite marvellous,
said the other Titus. Then Titus opened his mouth to lick some jam from the jar, but his tongue just kept getting longer and longer, and suddenly the other Titus had turned into his old geography teacher, and isn't it annoying when dreams go all weird like that? Willow, an extremely cute bunny, was sleeping next to her 153 brothers and sisters in their warren in Bunnyville, an area of Grimwood that had been completely taken over by bunnies.
Zap! Take that, losers! Zap!
In the dream, she was a massive giant robot bunny who could shoot lasers from her eyes, and she was stomping through the big city, blowing up cars and dustbins and aliens and stuff. Wiggy the Badger was snoring almost as loudly as his brothers, Monty, Jeremy, Jeremy, and Jeremy. He was dreaming about tucking into a large all-you-can-eat breakfast buffet. He dribbled.
Eggs, sausage, beans, bacon, toast, mushrooms, tomatoes, chips, hash browns, onion rings, and a burger thrown in for luck. Oh, and a strawberry milkshake. Hooray!
He reached for the bottle of tomato sauce and with an energetic he squeezed it all over his food, all over his head, and then all over the room until he was swimming in a gloopy sea of ketchup.
Hello, Eric Dynamite here. Just want to say, dreams are quite silly, aren't they? Just wanted to share that. Okay, thanks, bye.
Over in the grey waters of the small pond, Ingrid the duck was floating serenely on her island of shopping trolleys. She and her husband, Sir Charles Fotheringay, wore matching silk eye masks and fluffy slippers. Ingrid was having one of her very favourite dreams. She was at a swanky awards ceremony, perched high above the stage. Nobody could see her. Beneath her stood her greatest rival, Tufty Honeycake, an annoying young duck with big eyes and shiny golden feathers. Tufty had taken all of Ingrid's acting jobs, and now she was winning an award for Best Actress, which was utterly preposterous.
"I'd like to thank the Academy for this award," blubbed Tufty. "And those sad, tired old ducks like Ingrid, without them waddling a path, I wouldn't be here. Yay me!"
In a rage, Ingrid quickly and accurately did a big fat plop on Tufty's head. Tufty screamed. The audience gasped. Ingrid cackled in her sleep and turned over. Pamela the Eagle did not dream, because she did not believe in sleep.
"It is for wimps,"
she would cackle.
"While you pathetic weaklings sleep, I monitor suspicious activity through my security cameras."
Pamela lived in a tangled nest of old computers, phones and wires at the top of a huge electricity pylon known as the Magic Tower. It buzzed strangely, and so did Pamela.
"Awooga!"
came a mysterious voice, except it was not in any way mysterious, as we all know that Sharon the Party Crow is the only one who says
"Awooga!"
around here. Sharon now lived with Pamela. They were best pals, and even hosted a radio show together, which was actually very popular, don't you know?
"Hello, Eric Dynamite here. Just to warn you, Pamela does sometimes, bite people's heads off. I know, it's terrible. But nature is cruel. Just the other day, a butterfly made fun of my hat. It was very hurtful."
"Yeah, but your hat does look rubbish, pal."
"Yeah, thanks, butterfly. Do you mind if we carry on with the book?"
"Yeah, whatever, bad hat."
"Okay, thanks, bye."
The fox den in Grimwood had been empty for quite some time. But now, it was home to Ted and Nancy, a pair of scrappy young foxes who had moved from the big city. Ted was snuggled up with his cuddly slipper, which he called Slipper. He was dreaming of playing the guitar in front of thousands of screaming fans. It was brilliant.
"Hi, everyone," he cried. "This next one goes out to all the bunnies."
And he opened his mouth to sing, except he had forgotten all the words. So he made them up on the spot, and nobody minded.
"La la la, I love my spoon. Would you just look at the moon? Oh yeah, baby, my spoon."
The crowd went wild and started chanting, "Ted, Ted, 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 Ted." Then the crowd seemed to be slapping his face and shouting, "Oi, Ted, Ted, wake up." And he opened his eyes and saw that it was actually his big sister Nancy who was slapping him.
Oh, said Ted sleepily. "It was just a dream. Boo-hoo."
He rubbed his eyes and yawned. When he opened them properly, he could see it was still nighttime, and Nancy was pacing about the den, looking worried.
"What's up, sis?" he asked. "Why'd you wake me?"
Nancy looked down sheepishly at her paws.
"Did you have another weird dream?"
asked Ted gently. Nancy nodded.
"Yeah, I need you to write it down before I forget it. You're better at words than that."
Ted reached under his pillow for his pencil and notebook. Nancy had been having lots of weird dreams recently. Frank had told her to write them down to see if they were trying to tell her something.
"Okay," said Ted. "What can you remember?"
Nancy curled up on her bed.
"Weird noises," she said,
a sloshy, wishy-washy sound, and then like squawky birds. Ted wrote it down. Someone was whistling a tune, continued Nancy. Oh, what was the tune? Asked Ted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.